One of the things that is important about this conference is that we meet in many different contexts to discuss the issues of the impact of Islamophobia in many different contexts in relation to many different aspects of our lives, because it impacts in so many different ways. And we tend to have quite a complex awareness of the multiplicities of expressions and forms that Islamophobia takes. But very often when the discussion turns to causal aspects, it tends to narrow down quite fast to the notion that it's really about far-right movements. That's where the problem lies, and that's where we have to tackle it. And overwhelmingly, at least in my experience in workshops with the Muslim Council of Britain and so on, onto the notion of the media and how the media is to blame for Islamophobia. Now, there can be more and less sophisticated ways in which the media is discussed. The media is discussed in relation to the fact that it has a market logic, and supposedly it's catering to sales. The notion that it is ideologically linked to particular political positions and tries to generate support for particular framings that advance specific ideological agendas. The notion of the sensationalized logic that ties to market, but also to this ideological framing. Sometimes it's about, it does bring in the issue of the state, and it's in relation to regulation or not, whether it should be autonomously regulated, whether standards should be in place or not. And much of the focus of discussion about the media tends to be around issues of demonization. So the media and the way that it demonizes Muslims, it creates negative images of Muslims, it ties Muslims onto particular words and terms that are always negatively connoted. Now, one of the things that I always put so much emphasis on, and many of us do, is the way in which media representations focus both through the demonization and through the image of what is acceptable Muslim forms of being and work through the notion of the positive image of the Muslim as well. Finally, there's the notion of the media as opinion shaping, opinion forming and framing. Now, where it tends to be the case that the state is brought in is where the media is linked to issues of moral panics. Now, I think it's particularly important in the context of these discussions that we do give some attention, and that this conference does, to bringing the state back in and to putting some of the accent of the discussion on the questions of the state. Now, it's not that the state is absent from these discussions. Very often, the discussions focus on the question of the legislation, the need for legislation. But very often, in that respect, the state is seen as a neutral arbiter. The state can legislate on behalf of communities who advocate and plead for the different ways in which communities need to be protected or catered for. The question of moral panics tends to very speedily sometimes reduce to electoral politics and the ways in which political parties and political elites, rather than the state itself, manipulates these waves of moral panic. And finally, and quite a lot of literature on this, specifically in Europe, linked to the anti-war movement, and in the States, very largely advanced in critiques of Islamophobia, is the notion of the state involved in warmongering. So the way that Islamophobia works to legitimize imperialist wars in the form of intervention in foreign contexts. But there is scope and space to discuss the role of the state more widely. And I just want to briefly touch on three things. One is, the main one is in terms of bringing the state back in. And I would remind us that we all know that we tend to foreground one or the other, that Islamophobia manifests itself currently and articulates itself currently along two main interrelated but differentiated strands. One of them is the global war on terror and its various forms of franchising. And the other one is in terms of racialized conditional belonging, which is very much the ways in which we experience it in domestic spaces and in which we tend to think of the role of the state. Now, that is at the widest sense, the way in which social relations, the ways in which particular groups in society are identified, understood, thought of as existing groups with claims on the state or in relation to each other, to institutions, are embedded in particular ways in which the state recognizes and constructs these particular groups. We see this, of course, in particular, and we tend to conceive it in particular, in relation to the ways in which at one time race relations and today's equalities legislation recognizes characteristics that are protected, groups that are recognized, and this is embedded in legislation and the lens of the state. It is, of course, also present through the various armatures of the state, the services which it provides in the form of education, health, housing, policing, the judiciary, and security. And in each of these, it works differently and along different lines. But it is embedded in the ways in which the state conceives of particular categories and embeds the ways in which we relate to each other in terms of groups and categories. So if I say, for example, that one of the lines that I'd like to just remind us of is very present. If I look to another state in Europe, which publishes annual security reports, annual internal security reports, we see something that is present there, said, stated explicitly, that is at work elsewhere. So in a 2001 internal security report, it spoke of multiculturalism as having the potential to create conflict in the sense in which superdiversity and balkanization sort of filters and shapes so much of the debates that we have in our societies about the way that post-77 and elsewhere, Madrid bombing, Theo van Gogh, and so on, the notion that multiculturalism actually enabled enclaved communities to emerge, which then simply gave in to the logic of contestation and conflict. Or in another 2005 report on national security on, in this particular country, it spoke of the proliferation of enclaves of insufficiently integrated people, especially poorly integrated second generation immigrant communities, which, because of their non-integration and enclaved existence, were bound to generate responses of a xenophobic kind. So the very existence of the minority communities was to blame for the fact that it would cause extreme right racist reactions. Now, this notion that integration is a major political issue and that national identity and forms of creation of cohesion is one of the main concerns with the security approach to this permeates all of our discourses and has tended to become embedded in the current discussion around British values. Now, what I'd like to mention is a couple of things that relate to this. One is related to research. Now, again, it ties internal and international contexts together. When David Price, in his critique of anthropology in the context of the War on Terror, spoke of the ways witting and unwitting, direct and indirect, that anthropology interacts with intelligence, we are very aware in the of the ways in which this has now become embedded in the funding of research, in the way in which it is understood that some research in universities is more relevant and publicly accountable than others if it focuses on problems and can advise policies. The other would be the way in which Laura Nader, for example, spoke of the phantom factor of codependence between social science research and governance. And I think this is absolutely key for us to have in mind when we speak of the notion of universities being spaces of academic freedom and independent thought and so on. And we have to see the way in which so much of our research, because of funding, because of the way in which it is now impact factor related, generates particular foci of research enterprise. Now, one issue in particular relates to the question of representation. And we are so familiar, back in the 1970s, when groups, black groups in this country started mobilizing, the notion of self-appointed community leaders. So the notion that in the Pakistani community in particular, forms of organization were tribal, forms of organization were self-appointed, and that in order to represent their communities, the state today and governments today have to orchestrate forms of enabling other voices to come to the fore. Now, this particular game of selecting and deselecting who are the appropriate voices to be heard from communities is one of the major ways in which the field of Muslim representation is played, and the question of who are acceptable voices, who are representative voices, who speaks for the true Islam is promoted. We have to tie this to something very important, which is the fact that the role of the state and what the state is has changed a great deal. That notion that we had of the monolithic leviathan that is the state is no longer applicable today. And it has been mentioned in the earlier session, so much of what we understood as services of the state has been contracted into the private field. And this is from the areas of health, to the areas of welfare, to the areas of the military and security. And we have to understand in more sophisticated ways how the state is something, therefore, more than the government, and how it orchestrates the different areas in which communities are impacted, particularly in the context where big society and the current cuts mean that there is a sort of shrinking of the state, but through an overarching logic of the state contracting different sectors of society. And we have to understand the way that Islamophobia, therefore, is contracted out to so many of these other agencies. The one irony, perhaps, is this, that where Muslims had started to make really solid inroads into civic activism, engagement, and political engagement through local government, through learning the ways of local government as communities, occurred at exactly the same time in which there was an overhaul of the British state, in which the centralization of the state was taking place in Britain. And so just as Muslims were making inroads into forms of local government engagement and activism, the state shrunk back to the center with a devolution to communities without resources. The two little things that I wanted to say at the end, in the minutes that are left, are the following. That there is a form of Islam that in some older critiques was referred to as a home office Islam, but we may today more aptly call it the not in our name Islam, which is that the form in which Muslims establish themselves in relation to citizenship is by de-emphasizing their separateness or their identification as Muslims, by diluting themselves into forms of citizenship that is unmarked. Where they are expected to make salient their speaking in the name of Islam and of Muslims is only where it is in order to negate the other by saying, not in our name. And I think this is an extremely important form of the engineering of Muslim identities that is taking place, that goes hand in hand with the previous one that I mentioned, which is selecting and deselecting particular groups as the authentic voices that government will speak to, and it will not speak to those who will transgress the boundaries of what is the acceptable forms of privatized religion and so on. The last thing that I wanted to say is that what we need to do in response to some of this is to cultivate what I refer to as a cosmopolitan sociological imagination. But I say cosmopolitan for a reason. I say cosmopolitan because decolonial is scary. And what we really need is decolonial. But we'll use cosmopolitan because that's cuddly and that is what people are prepared to take. And if hate crime is political, it requires political mobilization around those issues. And it requires in particular the following, that if we know what the problems are, and we do, and governments do, and everybody who works on the field knows, which is underreporting, which is lack of prosecutions, which is a policing that doesn't signal the fact that it would be actually effective to report and to seek redress, then what we need is a political will to commit both in rhetoric and in resources to create a culture in which the state structures for what is called anti-discrimination action and the community bodies that exist to represent the communities to the Crown Prosecution Service and to the policing are enabled to do their job. And that can only come, and this is the final point, if we recognize that there is historic and structural form of disadvantaging of communities in their ability to claim their rights. It's not enough to have equal rights for everyone. It's important to have the means and the ability to prosecute on the basis of those rights.